This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do.
All you want to do is ride around Saturday.
You know, one of the more interesting subjects that comes up when you talk to people about riding is gaited horses. Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb here for The Horse Show. I always stop and take a breath and explain what we mean by gaited horses, in case that term is new to you. All horses have gaits, the different speeds at which they move and the different footfall patterns that go along with those. Every horse does the walk and the canter, and most of them do the trot as kind of an in-between gait. There's this other class of horses we call gaited horses who have a different middle gait, either instead of or in addition to the trot, that is a smoother gait. The trot is kind of a bouncy gait. If you've ever ridden a horse, you kind of bounce up and down on that middle gait there until you kind of get the hang of it, or you post or whatever you do to kind of compensate for that. But a gaited horse, instead of having that moment of suspension in the trot where you kind of come crashing back down, which is where the bounce comes from, a gaited horse always has at least one foot on the ground in that middle gait. They call that their signature easy gait, if you will. Examples: Tennessee Walking Horse, Missouri Foxtrotter, Peruvian Paso, Paso Fino, Icelandic horse like our Fiedla. There's lots of them out there. And the main difference is the way they accomplish that easy gait. Well, we're going to talk today with Dennis Pennington about how you pick your first gaited horse, if that's a direction you want to go, if you feel that would be easier on your joints, for instance, or you're just kind of fascinated with that particular. Oh, I forgot the Rocky Mountain horse. Probably my favorite all-time gaited breed. I knew I was forgetting something. Anyway, if you're interested, you can find out how to do that from Dennis Pennington today. Matt Sheridan is going to be here towards the end of the show to talk about teaching your horse self-control. Very important lesson that impacts your safety. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show, and we'll be back. Stay with us. Hey, everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Animal Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit truevalue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM premium horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit truevalue.com and search on ADM. ADM Animal Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at farnamhorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care. The Hoof Cinch treats founder from a whole new angle.
It just forces that new growth along the bone, and it actually reattaches.
Unlike conventional founder treatments, the Hoof Cinch is applied to the outer hoof wall. It stabilizes the capsule and reduces pain immediately. In 12 to 16 weeks, horses can return to whatever they did before. Get the full story and watch a short video at hoofcinch.com. Don't give up on your foundered horse. Take the first step and learn about the Hoof Cinch at hoofcinch.com.
I'm David Lichman with Pirelli Natural Horsemanship. I'm here today to talk about our U.S. servicemen and women partnering with horses for healing and recovery. Many return from service with injuries. Some you can see and some you cannot see. Here's how you can help. If I can raise $10,000 for equine therapy programs that directly help veterans, I will shave off the signature handlebar mustache I've worn as a trademark for the last 35 years. Go to my website, davidlichman.com, click on the mustache link to see the whole story.
Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com.
Now, back to the Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Welcome back, everybody. Coming to you today from the Rocky Mountain Horse Expo in Durango, Colorado. I'm Rick Lamb. This is the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. And my guest for this segment of my show is Dennis Pennington. Dennis, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, Rick.
Now, Dennis is an expert in gaited horses, and I asked him if he would talk with us today about the process of selecting the right gaited horse. But before we jump into that, tell people a little bit about your background.
The way I got started with the gaited horses, and particularly the Tennessee Walking Horse, was through field trialing with German short hair pointing dogs. About 11 years ago, I attended my first event with the dogs, and I realized that everybody at that time was riding horses to follow their dogs around through the designated course. At that time, I thought, well, I'm going to have to get a horse if I want to play this game for very long. My wife and I jumped in the truck, drove to Tennessee, purchased two Tennessee walking horses, and drove home, not knowing, not having ever had a horse before, or a gaited horse in particular. As a result of that, we had to learn very quickly. The Tennessee walking horse, as far as temperament, disposition, I couldn't have picked a better animal as far as my first horse, because it taught me a lot, and they were very forgiving, very easygoing.
Now, is that what most of the people in field trials were using for their
most
horses?
Of the people are using a gaited horse, whether it be a Pasifino, a Missouri Fox Trotter. Tennessee walking horse is probably the most prevalent that's used. Mm-hmm. But yes, they're all riding gaited horses. The reason being is that we're in the saddle from anywhere for 6 to 8 hours a day riding and following these dogs during the course of the field trial, so you need to have a smooth, comfortable animal that you can ride.
And you need to cover some ground.
You've got to cover a lot of ground in a short amount of time, especially if you're trying to keep up with the dogs, because the dogs are going at a high speed running the whole time, so we had to be able to follow the dogs, and when we're following them, we don't want to necessarily be loping or bouncing. We want to make sure that it's smooth and comfortable the whole time.
Now, that was 11 years ago. You've since educated yourself pretty thoroughly, it sounds like, because you're now winning national and world championships, correct?
Yes, as a matter of fact, I won my first championship, world championship this year. It was the Novice Western Trail Pleasure, this year's Tennessee Walking Horse National Celebration, held in Shelbyville, Tennessee every year. And I won an old little horse that I own that's called Clean and Sober. Last year, I was able to win 4 Reserve World Champions on 2 different horses that I'd taken out. The year before that, I won 1 Reserve World Champion. So we've been pretty successful so far.
So did you go to study with somebody that taught you what you needed to know, not only about horses in general, but Tennessee walking horses in particular, to be able to advance that quickly?
I guess I'm not afraid to go ask people questions. So whenever I'm out in a situation where there's people that are doing things with their horses, I'm pretty quick to go ask somebody about a particular thing that I may see, or... And a lot of it's just trial and error. I've been going to Tennessee for about the last 8 years or so, 4 of which we were just going out and watching the World Celebration. And then the last 4, we've actually been participating. So every time that I'm out there, I'll see something at a different barn that I happen to like, may ask a different question of a different person, and then just kind of take it home and try to apply it to my horses. And if it works, great. If it doesn't, I go back to the drawing board and try something else.
What made you want to compete in showing horses? I mean, you started this, it was kind of a means to an end to be competitive in another entire area, you know, the field trial.
Sure.
What made you want to then jump into showing horses?
I guess it was my wife. She actually, when we first got our 2 horses, she wanted something that could be a little bit more on the show side.
Yeah.
And so we got 2 different types of horses and 2 different styles of horses. And when I say that, we had one that's more geared for the show ring, and the one that I was actually riding was just more of a trail horse.
Mm-hmm. Now, how would you distinguish those two? How are they different?
With a trial horse or a trail horse, I'm probably going to be looking at one that's not going to have quite as much of a deep stride behind. A lot of what we base our Tennessee walking horses on is the back end. And what ties everything together is that back end, your head shake, and then your front end with the horse. I'm talking about front, I'm talking about his front legs, his back legs, and then his head shake. So this horse had a little bit deeper stride, was a little bit more in the bridle, a little more showy than actually what my horse was. For my trail horse, though, what I really liked about him was he didn't have that deeper, longer stride behind. When I got into some different types of terrain, he was more sure-footed, wouldn't stumble, and I felt real secure and comfortable on that horse because of that.
Well, good for you. Well, that's fantastic. Well, we kind of skipped ahead of this, but I want to go back and make sure if anybody's listening who doesn't understand our terminology, when we talk about a gaited horse, I mean, all horses have gaits. They walk, trot, and canter. How do you define to somebody who doesn't even understand the concept of gaiting horses, what they are?
Basically, what a gaited horse is it has a smooth, comfortable gait at a flat walk and a running walk. There's two different types of gaits, and every gaited horse is going to have these two distinguishable gaits with them. A fox trotter is going to have a flat walk and a fox trot. And the only difference with the fox trotter is a fox trot is going to be more of a diagonal gait, right rear, left front, left rear, right front.
That's the sequence of the footfall.
And with that footfall itself is what it's going to do is you're going to hear a four-beat gait. You'll hear it defined as a four-beat gait with these walking horses, with gaited horses, excuse me. A Tennessee walking horse is going to be a lateral gait, still a four-beat gait, as is a Pasofino, as is the rest of the Icelandics and so forth. These all gaited horses. But what the difference is with a non-gaited horse, you'll see a lot of the people in the rodeos and so forth where they're actually posting when they're doing their trot. Where with a gaited horse, you can actually stay sat smooth in the saddle and go at a high rate of speed anywhere from 5 to 15 miles an hour on this smooth, comfortable gait.
Yeah.
That's the best way I can
describe it. You don't have that moment of suspension is what I call it. When you're trotting, there is a moment, even if it's very, very short, when all 4 feet are off the ground, and then the horse comes back to the ground. And that's what gives the trot kind of a jarring sensation, where with a gaited horse, you've always got at least 1 foot on the ground, and usually more than 1 foot on the ground.
Yes. But all these horses have their purpose. I mean, whether it be if you're rodeoing, if you're in the arena for a speed event, something like that, all of these horses, whether it be gaited or non-gaited, have their purpose. Hmm. What I wanted and the desire that I wanted as far as the feel and the amount of time that I was in the saddle, I chose the gaited horse for that reason.
Well, and you're certainly not alone. It's probably the fastest rising segment, I would think, in the horse industry today.
Yes.
And I think that it corresponds roughly with the age group of the people in the horse industry. We have this huge baby boomer age wave that's now up in its 50s and 60s that still wants to ride horses but cannot tolerate, you know, the wear and tear on their body from a trotting horse.
Yeah, the bouncing and the posting and everything goes along with that. A lot of times I've had several people I've had the opportunity to expose to the gaited horse, and what's really happened with that is once they get on, they're coming from a different discipline, whether it be an Arabian or a quarter horse, they get on the Tennessee walking horse, and he starts to go into his flat walk, and they think the horse is running away with him. Mm. And I'm like, no, that's okay. Just settle down, just relax, and sit there and ride the horse. Then we go into the running walk, and the next they start to smile from ear to ear.
Yeah.
Because they're not bouncing, they're not posting, it's not beating up their knees, it's not hurting their back. All of these things, it's a real desirable situation with these horses. And like you mentioned, the baby boomers, it's really a breed, and especially the Tennessee walking horse, with what I'm more familiar with, has really started to take off as a result of that.
Now, is there any trouble within those breeds attracting young people?
Absolutely not. The only thing that hasn't really taken off out in the West out here is the problem we run into sometimes with 4-H. A lot of the judging criteria is set up so they don't necessarily understand a gaited horse versus a trotting horse.
Right.
So it makes it a little more difficult for a younger person that's involved in these aspects of the 4-H to get a gaited horse and be competitive in that arena.
From the Durango Rocky Mountain Horse Expo, this is the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. I'm Rick Lamb. My guest is Dennis Pennington, and we'll talk about picking your first gaited horse when we return. Stay with us. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin, 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel in Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. From the Durango Rocky Mountain Horse Expo, this is the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. I'm Rick Lamb. My guest is Dennis Pennington. We're talking about gaited horses. Suppose I came to you and I said, Dennis, I would like to get my very first gaited horse. How would you advise me on doing that?
The very first thing I would do is try to establish and determine what your goals are with that animal. Mm-hmm. If you want to get something that's more geared towards the show ring, if you want to get something that's more geared towards just the trail. But if I'm looking for a horse for you for the show ring, I look at probably just a little different style in their gait, some of the real deep stride behind, something that's going to shake his head real hard. Things that we can actually enhance with the horse. If he's got a fairly okay gait, we can enhance that gait, provided that he's built correctly to do that.
Now, would you just automatically, what you're describing there sounds like a Tennessee walking horse.
Mm-hmm.
Would you automatically kind of veer towards that in advising anybody, or would you consider like a Missouri Fox Trotter, Icelandic, Pasofino, whatever?
I would absolutely consider those. My forte wouldn't necessarily be in those areas, but I can sure see if it's a smooth horse. If we're going more for a trail type horse, I would absolutely look at those others.
Mm-hmm.
The temperament of the gaited horse, just in general, in all breeds is phenomenal.
Mm-hmm.
But I've really bonded with the Tennessee walking horse. And in fact, I've had the opportunity here this morning to talk to several people, and they just can't believe they're like a big puppy dog. They want to be with you the whole time.
The interesting little thing I always throw out when we talk about Tennessee walking horses, because I know a lot of our listeners are of the age bracket that they remember Roy Rogers and Gene Autry. They're star horses, Trigger and Champion.
Yes.
Both of them had Tennessee walking horses. Now, Roy Rogers had several Triggers, and only one of them really was a pure Tennessee walking horse.
That's correct.
Gene Autry, same kind of thing. He had several Champions, and I don't know if all of them were Tennessee walkers, but I know at least one of them was.
Right.
So they've been around for quite a while.
And the walking horse registry itself has been around for about 80 years. So, yeah, mm-hmm. it's a breed that's been around for a long time. And there's a lot of people. The more you talk to people, the more you watch. And as you mentioned with the movies, whenever I'm watching a Western nowadays, every once in a while you can see a gaited horse thrown
right.
in there. So it's kind of
right.
unique and it's neat.
And as you get used to what that looks like when a horse is gating, you can pick it up very
yep,
quickly.
Absolutely.
And you can probably even say, oh, they know that's a fox trotter.
You can tell the difference in the gates
exactly.
is what they're going to do. Yep.
And of course, we haven't spent much on the Spanish breeds, the Peruvian Paso and the Pasofino, but they are unique unto themselves even more. In very
yeah,
distinctive, and I'll just point this out, the Pasofino has a very short stride. So they have a lot of action, but they don't get too far
too fast. A lot of action, don't go very far.
Yeah. Right. And the Peruvian Paso, you can really tell that looking at it from the front because they have this terminoth thing. It's almost like they're swimming with their front leg goes out.
Yes,
paddle
out to
the
is
side.
What I call it.
Paddle,
yeah,
like they're paddling in the water, exactly. I'm going to ask you a tough question. Because when people hear about the Tennessee walking horse, a lot of times what comes to their mind immediately is these what they call the big lick horses, the
Correct.
Horses that are doing this very exaggerated gait where their front legs come up very, very high, and they have built-up shoes, and sometimes they're trained with some methods that have been very highly criticized.
Yes.
Soaring, to mm-hmm. be honest. How do you respond to that? I mean, is that part of the world that you live in your show world?
It absolutely is. One thing that I myself, my wife, we show what they call the flat shod division, which is just nothing more than a keg shoe or a little heavier weighted shoe, which would just be, we call it in a light shod or a plantation division. Mm-hmm. When you step up into the padded horse, what I would refer to it, you step up into more of a performance horse. Performance horse has been around probably all of those 80 years I just mentioned earlier. It's really quite a bit more prevalent east and all the way to the west coast than it is actually in the middle states right mm-hmm. now. I haven't particularly got into that realm of things as far as showing that. I've ridden a padded horse and it's an incredible and amazing ride. They're just a true athlete. I mean, there's no doubt about mm-hmm. it. But for me personally, it's not something that I have. And the reason being is, again, like I said, I couldn't take that padded horse and go ride him out on the trail.
Right.
And that's more of what I want to do with my horses.
Well, there's a certain amount of outrage that people outside of the Tennessee Walking Horse feel about the way those big leg horses are trained and shown. Do you think sometimes gaited horse trainers are a little bit misunderstood by the public?
There is some of that, absolutely. It's a learned situation where their dad's done it, their grandpa's done it, their great-grandfather's been involved in the industry, and it's just been passed
down
from years.
Just the way
it's
done.
It's just the way that it's done. Are there other ways that we could train these horses and get the same type of animation? Sure. Am I going to say that everybody's doing it? Absolutely not.
Well, the good thing, I think, about all of this is that all of these breeds, I believe, have at their shows, whether they call it a designated qualified person or some sort of an authority there, that's purpose is to determine whether any of those horses have been soared or abused in the training process in order to get
yes.
these exaggerated gaits. And if they have been, then those horses are disqualified. And I believe the trainers
get in trouble over it, don't they?
Very
stiff penalties go along with that, absolutely. Anywhere from a monetary fine up to not being able to show for a certain amount of time.
Yeah.
So, yeah, there's definitely a person there. And as you mentioned, it's a designated qualified person. There are several different, they call them HIOs that actually will go out and check and inspect these horses prior to and after they go into the show ring. There may have been problems in the past, and there may be some problems now, but they've really just stepped up their enforcement efforts to try to get that resolved.
And it's always better if it can be policed from the inside.
Absolutely.
What do you think is perhaps the biggest misconception people have about gaited horses in general? Not this showing issue I'm talking about, but is there anything that you struggle to kind of get across to people that aren't familiar with the
Absolutely.
Gaited horses?
What's the very first question that people ask me is, well, can the horse go in the mountains? Because I've seen them, they got this really neat gait and it looks like it's real fun to ride, but it's on flat ground. Can they actually go up in the mountains? The other one is, can they canter? And absolutely yes to both questions. I mean, we get some stuff, and you've seen the terrain around here, and I've had several people today have come up and talked to me and said, we ride our horses every single day
yeah.
in this type of terrain, and they love it. I mean, it's they're a phenomenal animal.
Yeah.
Absolutely. One guy mentioned to me this morning that he actually has a trail ride, a designated course that he rides here. And on this trail, he's actually had quarter horse thoroughbred mix, and now he's got Tennessee Walking Horses, and he clocked himself on this particular ride on the quarter horse that actually took him about almost 3 hours to make this particular ride, where on his Tennessee Walking Horse, he made it in two. Plus, he was smooth and comfortable the whole time.
I'm not surprised, because one of the things that's always been said, and I've found this out firsthand because I ride a quarter horse right now, is that if you go out with non-gaited horses and gaited horses, if you're on the non-gaited horse, like a quarter horse, you're going to be constantly trotting to catch up and then walking and then trotting and walking.
Yes, that is exactly true. The one thing, though, is these horses will slow down and walk with the quarter horse or with any other non-gaited horse.
Well, thank you very much for your time, Dennis, and congratulations on your wins.
I appreciate that very much.
And
Thank you.
For your foray into the expo world, I understand this is one of your first events.
This is, yes, the second one, actually.
All right. Well, good for you. And my guest again has been Dennis Pennington from Bluffdale, Utah. Dennis, thanks for being with us today.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate it, Rick.
Still to come, how would you like your horse to take responsibility for his own movement? Matt Sheridan will join us to talk about that idea when the Horse Show Live continues from the Wild Horse and Burro Expo in Reno. I'm Rick Land. Stay with us. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin, 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel in Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Animal Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit TrueValue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM premium horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit TrueValue.com and search on ADM. ADM Animal Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse. If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
Welcome back, everybody. Coming to you today from the Western States Wild Horse and Burro Expo in Reno, Nevada. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. And my guest for this segment of our program is Matt Sheridan of Sheridan Performance Horses. Matt, nice to see you again.
Good morning, Rick.
You've been staying pretty busy at this event?
Oh, we've been keeping very busy.
Well, you've got a number of things that I think are interesting topics unto themselves. We're going to talk just about just a few of them today and then open it up to questions from our audience here who've been kind enough to hang around after seeing you perform. I think they're probably filled with questions they'd like to pose to you. So we'll jump into a few here and up front and then open it up to them. You have a term, self-control, that you use when you refer to a horse. You want a horse to have some self-control, us to allow them to have self-control. That term, I think, needs a special definition. It's not exactly what people might think it would be. What do you mean by self-control?
Well, when we talk about self-control, Rick, basically when we're dealing with horses, they are used to being controlled. We bring them into a corral, we put a halter on them, we lead them around, we drag them around, if you will, sometimes. And so what I want a horse to learn is that when I'm on his back, he's a partner with me. He has a job to do and I have a job to do, and I need to rely on that horse. So if I'm doing something with him, I need him to kind of fill in some gaps, if you will, as we ride. So if, let's say we're doing a circle, I'd like to know that he will bend, that he will track forward, and that he'll respond to my leg as we do that. I don't want to have to be pulling and kicking and fighting with him and have his body going all over the place.
So once you've made it clear to him what you want, it kind of becomes his responsibility to continue until he hears something different from you, I would suspect.
That's right. He's basically operating under my direction. So he's under the general, if you will, at that point. And so I want him to follow my leadership, but I want him to be an active partner in that.
Yeah, and of course, it's going to be a better deal for him, because nobody
horse or human, likes to be micromanaged all the time. He doesn't want to be kicked and pulled on and all of that continually either. So it's really kind of in his best interest, as well as yours, for him to learn that kind of self-control. How does that tie into the idea of self-carriage?
Okay. When we're working on our circles, basically there's a lot that's going on. I'm not just walking a horse around in a circle out here. I'm actually looking at the shape the horse is creating underneath me. We're looking at his hips, his back and his ribs, his shoulders, and his head and neck. All those play a part in how he carries himself. If any part is out of alignment or leaning or pulling on me, he probably doesn't have good self-carriage. And that ties into when we teach collection in our horses. If they're round and correct, if that head is perpendicular to the ground, they're going to have good carriage and good collection when we ask for it.
Now, when a horse doesn't have naturally good self-carriage, even out in the pasture, is that a horse that, if he were in the wild, would probably not survive to reproduce and pass on that tendency?
Well, if he was a stallion, he's probably not going to be the winner at a fight, that's for sure.
Or even escaping predators and so forth.
Right. I think what we find is probably out in the wild, a lot of these horses have better carriage than when they're captured and trained by us. I think what we think we see in a horse when they're captured is not necessarily a good representation of what they would be like outside.
Oh, that's interesting. Well, I would think that part of that might be that their mind is a little bit preoccupied with some of the things that we're doing.
You bet. Say they're out in the pasture. They're in a contained area. So we may say, that horse doesn't move very good in that pasture. Well, for riding purposes, he may not move very good. But for survival purposes, he may move just fine.
What is the biggest or most common problem, I suppose, that you see in a horse that doesn't have good self-control or good self-carriage? We saw here just a moment ago a horse that tended to not lift his front end when you ask him to back up. He just kind of drug the front end. Is that one of the common problems, or is there another one that comes to mind?
No, that would probably be the most common thing we see, Rick. And what that is basically that horse is hollowing his back. He's bracing against pressure that he's anticipating. Naturally, if we were to observe him, he probably does not carry himself leaning on the bit, laying down out naturally in the pasture. Of course, he doesn't have a bit out in the pasture. But when we ride him, he's had experience where people have tried to control his every movement. They've been pulling on him constantly. And so as a way of defending himself, he's started to lean on that bit. And that's caused him to drop in the shoulders as a result.
Well, as you took over with that particular horse, I noticed that you ask a lot more of him. I mean, you were wearing spurs, and you didn't hesitate to use them. You got that horse moving out. Sometimes do you have to kind of break through some of the resistance that a horse has learned that he can offer?
Yes, I do. In the case of this horse, I ended up using my spurs a little bit on him. I didn't really use a lot of spur on him, but I used a lot of legs. So basically, from the knee to my calf, there was a lot of activity going on. And this horse, he needed a little wake-up call. Mm-hmm. He's been used to laying on things, particularly people's legs. So here, I used a lot of leg, a lot of activity, basically a fanning motion, if you will, to get him to wake up and start moving. Now, once that happened, of course, we had a lot of activity in his feet, and it was a lot of misguided activity. And that ties back into that self-control, because he didn't know what to do with his feet once they came alive. He knew what to do with them when they were asleep.
But but that is a good first step. I mean, you've got to get a horse moving before you can train him, and you got him moving.
Yes, because a horse that can move forward, we can direct. A horse that won't go forward, we can't direct.
And, of course, the idea there, I assume, too, is that, you break through that little bit of resistance, and the horse learns through your consistency and the way you offer the cues that the best deal for him is to always to move out at the earliest sign that you want him to, rather than when you've had to introduce a spur.
Right. And, one of the things we do as riders is we need to prepare that horse to move out. And one of the things we talk a lot about at our barn is hands, seat, and feet. You don't just kick a horse to get him to go. You push your hands forward, you adjust your seat forward, and then you use your legs. And hopefully somewhere along the way there, that horse is going to go ahead and move out before we ever would have to get to the spur.
And that's a consistent set of signals that you do in the same order, the same way every single time, correct?
Yes.
And that consistency, of course, is what the horse learns, how he learns to be softer and softer, because he's going to respond at the earliest part of the signal, correct?
Right, because the horse is going to, he becomes conditioned to it, basically, just as we build muscle memory.
Now, as you take a horse to a higher and higher level like that, it almost becomes just a shift of weight. You don't even have to really go through that series of cues, do you? I mean, it's almost like he senses what you want him to do just by a subtle shift in your weight.
I would agree with you to a point. I think what it is the cues become more subtle. so that they become almost unnoticeable. But the cues are still there.
Yeah.
The hand still pushes forward, the seat still adjusts, and the leg still moves. But the horse is reading it at such a high level at that point that you don't see it.
Now, if you get him to a certain level, if he moves out when you just simply move your hands, you're not even going to necessarily go through the other steps, are you? You may never even put your leg on him.
That's correct.
Yeah. How does this all tie in? You've got a great way of elaborating on the idea of the one-rein stop. A lot of people are familiar with the one-rein stop. It's taught a lot by all of us that promote natural horsemanship as a safety mechanism, a way of stopping a horse that is either out of control or seems to be getting out of control. Hopefully you stop him at the earliest time you can. We think of it as a safety device. You kind of take it beyond that as more of a training tool. Can you talk about the whole broad subject of the one rein stop in just 5 minutes give us a sense of all the things that it can accomplish?
Okay, without getting you a college degree in this, basically what we're looking for is to create balance in the horse. So as a training tool, what I'm trying to do is teach this horse to get round beneath me. So moving those ribs out of the way, keeping the shoulders elevated, and moving forward with his hindquarters. Once we go to the one rein stop, of course, we need the hindquarters to move away from us. So it's about yielding. It's about getting that horse soft all the way through his body. The one rein stop is just a way to control him, to get him pivoting on the front end, moving the hindquarters away. I may use it for gait work later on. I may be roping calves at a branding and need him to move his hindquarters over. So it's far more than just an emergency maneuver for me.
How do you teach people to practice the one rein stop? I mean, what is the scenario that you set up that they should use in which they can learn how to do it without panicking themselves and that their horse can learn what it means? And I'm kind of going back to the safety aspect of this.
Okay. When we think of the one rein stop, basically the first thing that needs to happen is we need to get short on that inside rein. We're going to shift our weight slightly inside. And then we're going to begin to use our leg to move the hindquarters. Now, let's say we're in an open field. You're not going to pull that horse around and immediately go into a one-rein stop, especially if he's at a dead run, because you're going to fall down. So what we need to do is we need to first get that horse directed with his feet, get the speed a little bit under control by directing it in a circle while he's still moving forward. Once he's slowed down, then we can go ahead, use that short rein, our weight shifted to the inside and that leg to drive the hindquarters away into the outside of our circle.
But if your horse is taken off and he's kind of in a panic mode, he's not going to be listening to subtle cues, correct?
Well, you'll have to amplify them a little bit.
How do you amplify them?
Well,
I'm asking for kind of a worst case scenario. You got a panicked horse, a rider that feels they need to get the horse brought to a stop.
Okay, we're going to reach down and you're going to have to pull us as firm as is necessary to get that horse to bend, and you'll have to use as much leg as is necessary to get him to move the hindquarters away. Preferably we've practiced this though, Rick.
Yeah.
To show up and just try it cold, you're really dooming yourself to a little bit of a wreck.
Well, and I agree with you 100% because I've been through that. I've nearly pulled a horse to the ground. I had him go down to a knee and almost come out of the saddle myself as a result of sort of executing a one-rein stop in a panic. So I know that what you're saying is absolutely true. By the same token, I also know that when you practice it ahead of time and the horse knows what it means, within a couple strides, you can bring that horse back under control.
Right.
So it doesn't have to get to the point where he's running off.
Absolutely. See, the thing that we forget as riders is we assume that the horse just went into a panic. He just became scared. The truth is there were preceding things that built up to that moment. And if we as riders are more aware and more tuned in to what our horse is getting ready to do, maybe we could kind of get in the way of what he's about to do.
From the Western States Wild Horse and Burro Expo in Reno, this is the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. My guest is Matt Sheridan, and when we come back, questions from the audience, and you know what that means, anything could happen.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
The Hoof Cinch treats founder from a whole new angle.
It just forces that new growth along the bone, and it actually reattaches.
Unlike conventional founder treatments, the hoof cinch is applied to the outer hoof wall. It stabilizes the capsule and reduces pain immediately. In 12 to 16 weeks, horses can return to whatever they did before. Get the full story and watch a short video at hoofcinch.com. Don't give up on your foundered horse. Take the first step and learn about the hoof cinch at hoofcinch.com.
that's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD TV.
RFD TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD TV and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at farnamhorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
In February's Horse and Rider, you'll learn technique on giving injections to the needle-shy horse, tips for tricking out your stall setup at shows, and advice on hosting a summer horse camp. Subscribe to Horse and Rider today and save. Call 1-800-829-3340. The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on 4 standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
We do appreciate the help, folks. My guest is Matt Sheridan. We're at the Western States Wild Horse and Burrow Expo, courtesy of the good folks at Daily 72. And we have some questions here from this lovely audience. Yes, ma'am.
I wanted to know when you were trying to back the horse up and he was dragging his shoulders or his front portion of his body, were you going to lift up on the reins to try to get him to lift up the front part when he's moving backwards?
Okay, when that horse was backing up, you notice he was dragging his front feet quite a bit. And what he's doing is basically he's pushing his back and rib cage and shoulders down towards the dirt. So if I start pulling, I'm actually going to pull him into that front end more, because what he's doing is he's basically bracing against what he thinks is anticipating as pressure. Okay? So all I do as a rider is I'm going to use my legs through a fanning motion to ask him, can you pick your ribs up and start to back up? If I start pulling, I'm going to cause that brace to increase. If I don't pull and only inhibit forward motion, eventually he'll start to pick his shoulders up.
So you're going to kind of set your reins. You're not going to be pulling back. You're just going to kind of create a wall.
Just enough of a wall to stop forward motion.
Yeah. And then you say fanning, you're kind of just tapping with your legs on the side?
Right. And that bumping is basically telling him, pick your ribs and your back up underneath me.
Now, are you increasing the pressure as you go, or is it just steady pressure?
I'm going to maintain it at that point. I'm going to give the horse an opportunity to work through it. And that relates back to that self-control. He has an option. He can resist it and fight with it and stand there all day, or he can kind of try to figure out a new way to go. See, when we give the horse the opportunity to find a way to go, he becomes a more willing partner. When we make him do it, he's just an animal that's being beat into submission.
Have you found that something that is true of all horses, or you see it in varying degrees, this willingness to try and do what you ask?
I think some horses are naturally born with a little more try. We're certainly breeding for it. But I think all horses will try for you, and if you don't get in the way of their honesty and what they are and keep them sort of pure, they're going to try very hard for you.
Good. Who else has a question or a comment? Yes, ma'am.
I was really interested in what you were doing. I have a 28-year-old gelding, and I got him at 21, and he was pretty much green broke. He'd just been out wrangling Mustangs and not really having to stop or anything. So he doesn't really carry himself. He doesn't bend, but he has real bad ring bone in his front feet, so I can't do tight circles. So are there other types of exercises that I can do to get him to bend and to carry himself?
I prefer to work in a 10-foot circle. Our accuracy level's going to go up tremendously. So then what you might do is you just work it in a bigger circle. I assume you're able to ride him on a straight line or out on the trail. So just increase the size of your circle and just work on getting that lateral flexion so that he's bending inside of the line that you're creating in that circle. Does that make sense?
It's just on the left side. He's sound to go forwards and sideways and backwards, but to go in a circle, it's pretty hard on him. But what I do find is out on the trail, I have a lot of opportunities to practice things in a natural setting that if we've done it in the arena and he's familiar with it, then he won't freak out. So I'm really interested in what you're doing.
Right. And remember, as you're riding, don't feel that you have to make those small circles. You're probably out among the brush or the trees or what have you, and I'm sure you're weaving through those trees and brush, right? So use them as a tool to train your horse to bend and circle. And he can learn to stand up because he's not going to want to fall down into a bush, I assume.
I liked what you were doing out there before, where you encouraged Cindy as she rode this horse to let him, I mean, not try and prevent him from bumping into things. Let him take responsibility for bumping into things.
He's been protected quite a bit. And I think he doesn't have a lot of ownership in what's going on all the time. So allow him to bump into things. We're still going to continue to create that direction. But by bumping into something, it sort of forces his hand to wake up and pay attention and become a partner in the deal. And there he's gonna move away from it, because I don't think he really wants to crash into things as he's going around out there.
Well, also, and so many horses that are too much on the front end, if you turn them into something, they have to get back on their hocks a little bit more just to get out of the situation, right?
That's correct.
Yeah. Who else has a question or comment?
Matt, you're talking about using hands, seat, and feet and that kind of order. It makes sense to me, moving a horse forward, you're giving him more reins, you're leaning forward a little bit, and if this doesn't help, you use some legs. How about stopping a horse? Would you use those cues in that order too?
I would. A lot of people think that you sit down and then you pull. But if I don't get short on my reins, which are attached to my hands, then when I sit down, if I have a long rein, I will not be able to reinforce what it is I want in the stop. So I still use my hands, seat, and feet, but I use them a little bit differently. I shorten the rein, which is my hands component, then I sit down, then I use my feet to keep me from flying up forward on the horse's neck when he actually stops nicely for me. So it's still the same order. And think of it this way, guys. If I sat down and pushed my feet in and said my woe and the horse didn't respond, I'm gonna start the order again. It's gonna be hands. Now my hands are really reinforcing what I've already asked him to do. My seat's gonna be a little deeper because he actually may decide to stop this time, and I may have to push with my feet a little bit more to keep my seat.
Good answer, good question. Anybody else?
We have a Mustang. I adopted it. He was about 4 years old. It's about 16 now, but he still has a problem with people picking up his back feet. Every farrier that I get, they barely survive. He cow kicks them, whatever. He try to just get them out of the arena. So what do you do to be able to pick up his back feet? Do you have to give him a shot or tie him down or what?
I wouldn't do anything quite that drastic. With a horse that has trouble with the hind feet, or any foot for that matter, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to get a soft cotton rope usually, or something that I can get where I can basically lay it out around their back legs. I use a lariat a lot of times at home, and I'll just practice swinging a rope and roping those hind legs till they get where that kickiness goes out of them, so they're not hypersensitive to something touching that leg. Once we're at that point, then I like to get a rope where I can run it around behind the leg and come back up. Usually a soft cotton rope, again, works very well, and I'll just teach that horse to yield to the pressure of the rope, to lift their foot forward, sideways, and backwards. Once they can yield to that pressure in all three directions, I'll then start working on rubbing down the leg. There's a bunch of steps in here, and I don't know if we can get to them all, but basically, you're gonna turn your body away from the horse because you don't wanna get kicked. So if you're facing the horse, you're more likely to get struck or kicked in the kneecap, and that would hurt. So what you do is you turn away from the horse and run your inside hand down the leg. So if I'm on the left side, I'm gonna run my left hand down his leg, okay? I'm going to run that hand down his leg to about the hock. If he'll accept it, I'm going to bring my hand back up, rubbing the whole time. I'll continue to do that, working my way down into the leg in successions. Okay? Once I get down there, I will still have that rope on his foot. I will use the rope to pick up his foot and not my hand. I'll pull the foot forward, and then I'll cup the foot in my hand for maybe a brief second and let him set it back down. Through a series of successions, he will learn to accept me picking up a hind foot.
A couple comments I'd just like to make about what Matt said. Number one, in the beginning, you can expect resistance. You can expect him to be kicking out and so forth, and that's exactly why you protect yourself by doing this from a distance with a rope. The key thing is that when he kicks out, he's trying to get you to stop doing this, so you can't stop doing it. You have to be committed to going on through with it. But if you do like Matt says, you're going to be in a position to protect yourself. We don't want you to get hurt. That's the number one thing, because that'll discourage you from doing anything further with this horse and this problem. The other thing I'd like to comment is what Matt's talking about, this starting and going down a little ways and then coming back up and going a little bit further and then coming back up. That's a thing that's called advance and retreat, or approach and retreat. And you see that used a lot. The old timers that I wrote about in my book, The Revolution in Horsemanship, up to modern horsemen like Matt, all use this in various forms. And the idea is you want to retreat before the horse panics. So you're kind of building up his ability to tolerate this just a little bit at a time. You go a little bit further each time and come back to the safe zone where he feels comfortable before he panics. But each time you're kind of raising his tolerance. Able to accept a little bit more, and that's how you finally get down to the bottom. And as Matt said, the first time you pick up that foot, don't be greedy. You want to set it right back down before he wants to take it away from you. And the trick here always is that you give it back to him before he wants to steal it back, before he tries to take it back. So it's it takes some human self-control to do these things, because our natural tendency is if we get a little bit of success, we want a lot of success. We want to just push right on through for our end goal. But going a little bit at a time, as Matt explained, is really the key for a lot of these horses. My guest has been Matt Sheridan, SheridanPerformanceHorses.net. .net. Okay. Thank you all for coming.
And there you have it, my friends. Special thanks to my guest today, Mr. Dennis Pennington, Mr. Matt Sheridan. I want to remind you again very briefly about the Hawaii Horse Expo. Start planning it now for this summer. It's on the Big Island of Hawaii, August 6th and 7th of 2016. Website for more information is HawaiiHorseExpo.com. And if I were you and I made some living off of my horses, I would, and they were not just purely hobby, I would certainly ask my accountant if this could be considered continuing education for tax purposes. You'll be learning a lot. I'll be hosting it. Richard Winters will be there. Dr. Robert M. Miller, veterinarians, and other great horsemen to be announced. The Hawaii Horse Expo. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Lamb.